Hello guys, this is Leo the Wise, giving to all men, their needed uprise.
Hello men, hoping you are fine today. This time I want to share a subject that I have seen within the well-known website MGTOW.com. It talks about the Sexodus, aka, men escaping the plantation. Originally this was originally authored by the popular in his time, Milo Yiannopoulos, originally published on Breitbart.com. Not that I support the guy neither this right-winged website, but have to give back what's due and that's all. I splitted the video into four parts due to YouTube restriction time for the content, sorry about that. This is the first part of the video, let's dive in and let's begin. My generation of boys is fucked, says Rupert, a young German video game enthusiast I've been getting to know over the past few months. Marriage is dead. Divorce means you're screwed for life. Women have given up on monogamy, which makes them uninteresting to us for any serious relationship or raising a family. That just the way it is. Even if we take the risk, chances are the kids won't be ours. In France, we even have to pay for the kids a wife has through adulterous affairs. In school, boys are screwed over time and again. Schools are engineered for women. In the US, they force feed boys Ritalin like Skittles to shut them up. And while girls are favored to fulfill quotas, men are slipping into distant second place. Nobody in my generation believes they're going to get a meaningful retirement. We have a third or a quarter of the wealth previous generations had, and everyone fleeing to higher education to stave off unemployment and poverty because there are no jobs. All the WOULDN be so bad if we could at least dull the pain with girls. But we e treated like pedophiles and potential rapists just for showing interest. My generation are the beautiful ones, he sighs, referring to a 1960s experiment on mice that supposedly predicted a grim future for the human race. After overpopulation ran out of control, the female mice in John Calhoun Mouse Universe experiment stopped breeding, and the male mice withdrew from the company of others entirely, eating, sleeping, feeding and grooming themselves but doing little else. They had shiny coats, but empty lives. The parallels are astounding, says Rupert. Never before in history have relations between the sexes been so fraught with anxiety, animosity and misunderstanding. To radical feminists, who have been the driving force behind many tectonic societal shifts in recent decades, that a sign of success, they want to tear down the institutions and power structures that underpin society. Never mind the fallout. Nihilistic destruction is part of their roadmap. But, for the rest of us, the sight of society breaking down, and ordinary men and women being driven into separate but equal misery, thanks to a small but highly organized group of agitators, is distressing. Particularly because, as increasing numbers of social observers are noticing, an entire generation of young people, mostly men, are being left behind in the wreckage of this social engineering project. Social commentators, journalists, academics, scientists and young men themselves have all spotted the trend. Among men of about 15 to 30 years old, ever-increasing numbers are checking out of society altogether, giving up on women, sex and relationships and retreating into pornography, sexual fetishes, chemical addictions, video games and, in some cases, boorish lad culture, all of which insulate them from a hostile, debilitating social environment created, some argue, by the modern feminist movement. You can hardly blame them. Cruelly derided as man-children and cry-babies for objecting to absurdly unfair conditions in college, bars, clubs and beyond, men are damned if they do and damned if they don't, ridiculed as basement dwellers for avoiding aggressive, demanding women with unrealistic expectations, or called rapists and misogynists merely for expressing sexual interest. Jack Rivlin is editor-in-chief of student tabloid media startup The Tab, a runaway success whose current strap line reads, "We all stop writing it when you stop reading it." As the guiding intelligence behind over 30 student newspapers, Rivlin is perhaps the best-placed person in the country to observe this trend in action, and he agrees that the current generation of young men find it particularly difficult to engage with women. Teenage boys always have been useless with girls, but there's definitely a fear that now being well-intentioned isn't enough, and you can get into trouble just for being clumsy, he says. For example, leaning in for a kiss might see you branded a creep, rather than just inept. The new rules men are expected to live by are never clearly explained, says Rivlin, leaving boys clueless and neurotic about interacting with girls. That might sound like a good thing because it encourages men to take the unromantic but practical approach of asking women how they should behave, but it causes a lot of them to just opt out of the game and retreat to the sanctuary of their groups of lads, where being rude to women gets you approval, and you can pretty much entirely avoid one-on-one socializing with the opposite sex. There are also a lot of blokes who ignore women because they are scared and don't know how to act. It goes without saying that boys who never spend any time alone with women are not very good at relationships. Rivlin has noticed the increased dependence on substances, normally alcohol, that boys are using to calm their nerves. I heard a lot of male students boast about never having experienced sober sex, he says. They obviously scared, which is natural, but they would be a lot less scared and dysfunctional if they understood the rules. The result? A lot of nice but awkward young men are opting out of approaching women because there is no opportunity for them to make mistakes without suffering worse embarrassment than ever. Most troublingly, this effect is felt more acutely among poorer and less well-educated communities, where the package of support resources available to young men is light. At my alma mater, the University of Cambridge, the phenomenon barely registers on the radar, according to Union Society President Tim Squirrel. I don't think I really noticed a change recently, he says. This year has seen the introduction of mandatory consent workshops for freshers, which I believe is probably a good thing, and there's been a big effort by the Women Campaign in particular to try and combat lad culture on campus. The atmosphere here is the same as it was a year ago, mostly nerdy guys who are too afraid to approach anyone in the first place, and then a smaller percentage who are confident enough to make a move. Obviously, women have agency too, and they approach men in about the same numbers as they do elsewhere. There certainly haven't been any stories in campus newspaper the tab about a sex trot on campus. I think that people are probably having as much sex as ever, he adds. At Cambridge, of course, that may not mean much, and for a variety of socioeconomic and class-based reasons the tribes at Oxford and Cambridge are somewhat insulated from the male dropout effect. But even at such a prestigious university with a largely middle and upper-class population, those patronizing, mandatory consent classes are still being implemented. Squirrel, who admits to being a feminist with left-of-center politics, thinks they a good idea. But academics such as Camille Paglia have been warning for years that rape drives on campus put women at greater risk. If anything, women today are schooled in victimhood, taught to be aggressively vulnerable and convinced that the slightest of perceived infractions, approaches or clumsy misunderstandings represents assault, abuse or harassment. That may work in the safe confines of campus, where men can have their academic careers destroyed on the mere say-so of a female student. But, according to Paglia, when that woman goes out into the real world without the safety net of college rape committees, she is left totally unprepared for the sometimes violent reality of male sexuality. And the panics and fear-mongering are serving men even more poorly. All in all, education is becoming a miserable experience for boys.
And that is it for now. If this content was entertaining and interested you, please share, like, and subscribe to this channel. I am the Swan, leading Men Till Dawn. and even beyond. Thanks for the audience.